Hi, my name's Alex Burrows. I'm the director at the Birmingham Centre for Railway Research and Education. I'm joined by Stuart Hillmanson. Stuart, do you want to say a bit about yourself?
Yeah, my name's Stuart. I'm a senior lecturer here at the university, and I've been developing hydrogen fuel cell trains over the last few years.
And you may have noticed last week we had a big launch of Hydroflex, which is the UK's first hydrogen-powered train. It got a lot of attention in the world's media, which is a hugely exciting development. I've been covered by many news outlets, including the BBC, Mail Online and others. That was launched at Rail Live, which is a big UK rail show that takes place in Warwickshire at the Quinton Rail Technology Centre. Now, we've been asked a few questions about the hydrogen train. I think a lot of people have seen a bit about it and want to find out more, and we've had some questions. So we're going to answer a few of those today. And Stuart, we're going to start off talking around why all of a sudden are hydrogen trains all over the news, quite simply.
Well, that's a really good question. A lot of people have been asking that. And there's a number of factors here. If I just talk through some of the technical aspects, and then maybe you can talk about the political and social framework.
Okay.
Fuel cells over the last few years have been developed and been shown to be proven to be robust and operated in several different sectors. So the bus industry, for example, have been using fuel cells, and there are a number of bus companies currently in operation around the world and in the UK. So the fuel cell is now a mature technology. Coupled with that is the fuel tank system. That also is now mature and readily available. And we use those products in our Hydroflex demonstrator. So that's only a relatively recent development, that they've reached the level of maturity and robustness that would be appropriate for the railway system. And that's happened. And at the same time, if I hand over to you, Alex, there's been a political move to decarbonise the rail industry.
Well, that's right. And the government have been very clear. They want to see diesel trains or diesel-only trains off the rail network in the UK by 2040. Now, that's only 21 years away, which in rail terms is not very long, given trains have a life of around 30 to 35 years. In addition to that, we're seeing a much greater focus on air quality, on emissions, and on the impact of climate change. And you're seeing with a number of cities, including here in Birmingham, the introduction of ultra-low emission zones, as well as research onto air quality, which is showing stations like our station, Birmingham New Street, just up the road, the actual air quality for passengers and staff is not good. And there needs to be a change. There needs to be a focus on the railway moving away from a reliance on diesel engines and towards electric trains using energy from not just overhead wires, but from alternative sources where, at the moment, only diesel trains can go. Which leads on to another good question.
Yep.
Where is the hydrogen coming from, Stuart?
That is another really good question. and it's one that comes up a lot when we talk to people and talk to the public about this. And it's a really, really valid point. Hydrogen isn't an energy source that's available naturally. So you can't go and dig it out of the ground. We have to create it from something. And the beauty about hydrogen is it's a very common element, and it's available in lots of different forms. So we're able to create it from energy sources and from renewable sources. So it's what's known as an energy vector. So we need to put energy in to create the hydrogen, and then we can use it in the train and create electricity and run the train's traction systems. That leads on to another important point about hydrogen is if you're using electricity to produce the hydrogen, why don't you use the electricity directly? And that's true. The most efficient way of powering a train is via overhead line and directly into the train. And then that leads on to another question: why don't you do that for the other parts of the network? And maybe, Alex, you can describe our network and why we can't do that everywhere.
That is a really important point. So at the moment, around 35% of the UK's railway network has overhead wires. In addition, another small part around London has a third rail, so another rail which carries electricity alongside two running tracks, which also provides electricity as a source into the trains. Now, the problem with electrification, it's got a bit expensive recently. We've had a few issues as an industry with delivering cost effects for electrification. And that has made the government reticent to invest significant capital sums on putting more overhead wires in. So we're at this kind of halfway house where we know we want a greater, more electrified network, and we want a cleaner network for sure. but we can't afford the cost of electrifying more parts of the network. And so we're seeing a move towards what's called discontinuous electrification, where trains will be expected to run under the wires using the electricity from overhead wires to power themselves. But then there'll be elements of the journey where they will then move across to being self-powered, which is currently using diesel engines. And so if you're interested in the railways, you may have heard of bi-mode trains, which are both diesel and electric trains. And we're seeing a lot of those being introduced. And I think what we're trying to do here is to create that alternative to that, those diesel engines, so that hopefully at some point in the near future we can switch out the diesel engines for the hydrogen technology, so that they will be completely clean. But quite simply, you are not going to see a fully electrified railway network in the UK, certainly in our lifetimes, simply because it isn't cost effective to do so. You are not going to be able to invest that kind of capital expenditure on putting wires up in very remote branch lines in the far north of Scotland, far west of Wales, and down in the southwest. It isn't economically viable, so we need some kind of alternative, and that's what this is going to be. But just going back to that earlier question then, and I've heard a lot around the difference between green and brown hydrogen. Yep. Is that something you could build on for us, Joe?
Yeah, so hydrogen can be produced in a 100% renewable way, using renewable generation like wind turbines, solar and so on. That electricity is then fed through an electrolyzer, and the input to that is water, and the output is then hydrogen and oxygen. That hydrogen then can be used as the fuel for a hydrogen fuel cell train. If you notice, I've not mentioned fossil fuels at all in that, so it is possible to make hydrogen with zero fossil fuel input. That's defined as green hydrogen. It's not relying on fossil fuels at all, and we can then produce a mobile fuel which is possible to power autonomous rail vehicles in the future. So that's the long-term vision for this. And given that now we have a very high proportion of renewables in our electricity generation, we have times in our energy system where we're curtailing wind energy. So we're not using all the electricity that we're producing. That means it's quite cost effective to use that energy to produce the hydrogen at a cost which is competitive for the rail industry, and it'll allow the rail industry to power their trains without having to significantly change their pricing policy, probably virtually zero impact on the cost of running a rail vehicle. Then there's a short-term step in between that. So you can produce hydrogen from natural gas, and that's how most hydrogen is produced currently worldwide. That then also produces carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide that's produced from steam methane reforming is a very, very high purity carbon dioxide. You've probably drank it in your fizzy drinks. So it's used for fizzy drinks and other processes, food packaging, all sorts of stuff like that. But ultimately it gets released into the atmosphere. You could also capture that carbon dioxide and sequester it. And then that would give an intermediate somewhere between green and brown hydrogen. So the great thing about hydrogen is it's got lots of options for its production, and ultimately can be produced using zero fossil fuels and be completely zero carbon.
So hydrogen can be completely green, and it's really a choice depending on the source of energy to provide that. Okay, fantastic. But the costs, we've had questions about the costs of producing the hydrogen and then the cost of installing it onto trains. I mentioned earlier the cost of electrification is huge, and we're looking for that middle step. And is this realistically, cost-wise, we're getting to a better point, aren't we, in the affordability sense?
Yeah, so ultimately fuel cells aren't significantly more expensive than the diesel engines they're replacing. So diesels in rail vehicles are fairly expensive, and the fuel cells will be a comparable price. So it's not necessarily going to increase the cost of a vehicle. The fuel cost may be a little bit more than diesel is right now, but one thing that's in favour of a fuel cell vehicle is we've moved away from combustion. And combustion has got a theoretical upper limit on its efficiency. So is a fuel cell, but because a fuel cell is using a different mechanism to produce the energy, it's ultimately more efficient. Fewer moving parts and good reliability. It's also potentially very, very quiet, and will give the customer a similar experience to riding on an electric train.
Which is an important thing. Diesel trains, obviously, what are the emissions? They are slower, more expensive to maintain and run, aren't they, by comparison? couple of questions we've also had. One was around there's a hydrogen train been introduced in Germany called the Kradia Island, which there are a couple of them actually running in commercial operation. And we were asked a few times last week, why don't you just bring them to the UK? Now, there is a simple answer to that. And one advantage, of course, we have in the UK is the railway was invented here. It was introduced here far earlier than many other countries. But unfortunately, the advantage of being first mover was then lost by having smaller infrastructure. Right. So our bridges and tunnels are actually narrower and lower than tunnels and bridges in France, Germany, across the rest of Europe. So sadly, a German train cannot get onto the UK network, and it certainly wouldn't survive very long if it did, as it have its roof ripped off, which would be very unfortunate. And that's why we can't do that. We have to develop from scratch a UK solution to UK standards, I'm afraid. So we've had to develop the train from scratch here, haven't we?
Yep, that's right.
So I think that's all the questions we've got for now. If you have any more questions, please do drop them into the comments below. We can come back and answer some more questions at some point. We're hoping that Hydroflex will be out for public display again in the near future. Actually, do you want to talk a bit around next phase of the project, Stuart?
So at Rail Live, if you've seen some of the footage from the demonstrations there, we ran the train at quite a modest speed. And me, as an electrical engineer interested in traction, we're quite keen on going faster. So we have installed a lot more power in the train than was on display at Rail Live. And the next stage is to increase the speed that we're running the train at, first on a test track, which we'll do in the coming months, and then we've got a plan to take it onto the mainline network, and that process is really exciting for us. There's lots of things that we need to consider about running on the mainline network. It'll be the first time hydrogen has been used on the real railway, so there's lots of safety case considerations we need to go through. So we'll be busy doing that in the near future. So we're really excited about doing that.
So it's an exciting time for our work developing hydrogen trains. And if you have any more questions, please do let us know.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.